Planning Commission. At this time, we ask you to turn off your pager, cell phones, or other electronic signaling devices. The procedures for this public hearing are located in the lobby, along with the agenda and copies of staff recommendations for today's meeting. Meeting schedules and agendas for the City Planning Commission are available online. Staff reports and maps for the City Planning Commission hearing will be available online approximately 1 week prior to the public hearing. To access this information, log on to www.norfolk.gov/planning. If you wish to speak on an item on today's agenda, you must fill out a request form with a staff member located in the council chamber lobby. We normally hear items in the order in which they are listed on the agenda. The Planning Department staff will introduce each item by stating the type and purpose of the application and the location of the property. A staff member will deliver a presentation on each item, followed by a recommendation on each application to be delivered at this hearing. Following the staff presentation, the Commission will hear from proponents and then from opponents if there are anyone. Anyone who has signed up to speak will be called by the chair. He or she shall approach the podium, state his or her name and mailing address. The speaker should speak directly to the Commission and not to the audience. Remarks will be limited to 3 minutes each. However, the applicant's time will not be limited. After all proponents and opponents have been heard, the Commission will allow rebuttal first from proponents, then opponents. Total time for rebuttals are limited to 5 minutes each. At the conclusion of the hearing on each item and after considering all information presented, the Commission will take action on the matter. Action on each matter by the Commission will be recommended approval or denial by majority vote. The statement of the motion in the affirmative by a member of staff is a matter of voting procedure and in no way indicates the recommendation of the staff or consensus of the Commission. Following the action by the Commission on the matter, a written recommendation will be made to City Council, except for those applications where the decision of the Planning Commission is final. Anyone who attends Commission public hearings for a specific item will be notified by the City Clerk's office on the date on which the City Council will consider the application. However, it is the responsibility of each applicant to contact the City Clerk's office to confirm the hearing date and the time of the City Council public hearing. Susan, call the roll.
Note that Mr. Fraley is absent, and note that Ms. Austin is absent. Ms. Shelton?
Here.
Mr. Bateman?
Here.
Mr. McGee?
Here.
Ms. Sutter?
Here.
And Mr. Murphy?
Here. Thank you. We'll start with the continued agenda.
So before taking up the items on today's agenda, we do have a request for a continuance. And that is continued agenda item number one by the City Planning Commission for Zoning Text Amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance to amend the East Beach Plan Development Mixed Use PDMU East Beach District. And that would be continued until the October 27th, 2022 meeting. So the motion would be to continue that item. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. On to the regular agenda.
Okay. The first item on the regular agenda is a request by the City Planning Commission for a general plan amendment to Appendix C within Plan Norfolk 2030 to adopt the City of Norfolk Midtown Plan. Chris?
Good afternoon, Planning Commission. As Susan mentioned, this is a general plan amendment to the general plan, Plan Norfolk 2030, to the Appendix C within the plan to adopt the City of Norfolk Midtown Plan. So this would be then an adoption of the plan by reference, which is common for us to do for new neighborhood or area plans within the city. And so I'll go through our the process and the recommendations and kind of how they were developed. And I'll note that the plan itself was developed by Urban Design Associates as well as work program architects for the city. So the beginning with the public process, it took place over the course of the last 5-6 months or so, beginning really the last part of the year 2021 in December. So there was a whole host of listening sessions at the end of the year and the last year and beginning of this year, really connecting with the different stakeholders of the area and determining, you know, what the issues, strengths, weaknesses, and opportunities might be at the area. And then just throughout the whole process, February through April, we actually had quite a robust series of both virtual and in-person public input sessions and opportunities. As you can see, there were lots of different methods that were used, including flyers, social media, Zoom meetings, and other virtual methods, and lots of community members in attendance at the in-person meeting. So quite a robust outreach method, but also participation from different civic leagues, as well as business owners and other stakeholders in this area. And so just to talk about the area itself a little bit, this is Midtown, is as it is in this plan, is really the nexus of many different neighborhoods. It's sort of a triangular-shaped area in the city, right between the Railroad District, the Park Place neighborhood, Villa Heights, Lindenwood, Cottage Heights, Broad Park, and Old Huntersville, and then the Railroad District, of course, surrounding on a couple of different sides. So you can see here the strengths of Midtown that were really conveyed by the community during those listening sessions that I mentioned. And some of the things that came out of that were, you know, one of the big things is the location. It is this nexus between different neighborhoods, different corridors in this part of the city. So it already had an existing and inherent strength given where it is in relation to the other parts of the city. And then, you know, kind of existing businesses, some of the activity that had occurred there over some time, there were lots of great existing businesses there to sort of provide a good foundation for the future. So that was noted as well. You know, there's a rich history because it's surrounded by so many neighborhoods. There is a rich history and a very rich culture here to also kind of celebrate with this place that is the nexus of all those different neighborhoods. So they presented a really good opportunity to do that and kind of lean into that. But there were a lot of weaknesses as well. You know, as a typical area, you know, in a sort of historically industrial part of the city, there's not a lot of green space. That was definitely one of the weaknesses that came out of this, that the stakeholders were very vocal about. But also, you know, not a lot of destination sort of based uses, places to park to get to a potential destination in this area. And, you know, not great connectivity, you know, because it's surrounded by all these great neighborhoods, but yet it has become kind of an impediment or a you know, kind of barrier between all those different neighborhoods. So it's hard to traverse, especially on foot or by bicycle. And just, I think, sort of a lack of a true coherent identity. I think, you know, this process really would help. It was intended to help bring these neighborhoods together to try to create sort of this place that they can all celebrate and merge these different neighborhood identities into one. So that those weaknesses were kind of the main ones that came out of the process. And then, of course, that developed into the vision. You know, things like creating a mixed-use neighborhood, taking advantage of the abundance of city property here. So that's something that, you know, given the opportunity presented with city properties and the ability to vision these areas that we have control over, it was a very important part of the process as well. People really thought that, you know, having homeownership opportunities, residential here, would be a plus because, you know, people don't really live here. There are some business activity, but there's not a lot of residential there. So by, you know, having this mixture of uses there, I think it would bring a lot of activity to the area and kind of help with that, you know, lack of identity, so to speak. And then, of course, trying to connect what positives you see on Church Street with the green space and the green kind of corridor there, bringing some of that into this area there's an opportunity there to do that as well and try to connect this area within and without a little bit better. So this was and also a chance to really have an inclusive economic job training and sort of economic development opportunity given the rich diversity of neighborhoods around the site. So that led to these five big design principles. So making this more of a destination, you know, came out very clearly given the location and its, you know, inherent kind of value as this place that is so close to major nodes like downtown, the energy in the Railroad District, and other commercial corridors around here. So bringing these different entities around here into this particular area, there was a real opportunity for that. Again, reinforcing and developing high quality pedestrian connectivity. So You know, that was one of the big weaknesses that came out of the process. So how do we better connect different amenities and businesses and public spaces within this area and on the borders of this area better through pedestrian infrastructure and bicycle infrastructure? Bringing new residential uses to the area, I mentioned that earlier. So that would be a huge part of this because, you know, being this kind of live, work, play environment kind of around the clock would require that mixture of uses. And, you know, having different scales as well, you know, that way opening the door for all kinds of different development, equitable types of development, because we're sort of allowing for these different scales and opportunities to develop different kinds of buildings and forms. And you'll see that a little bit in the renderings. And again, the mixture of uses that allow people to live, work, and play here. So this graphic clearly shows, you know, really reinforces the location, you know, being so close to downtown, so close to all the rich neighborhood histories around here on the west and the east of the site. And, you know, really is a short commute to many places in the city in general. So it's a really kind of ideal spot for the study. And I mentioned the options with green spaces. So there were a few that came out. So just to have a few options based on, you know, what type of green space the community wanted to see, whether it was more of a central park, whether it was a string of parks kind of throughout the study area, or this green belt idea that would traverse north-south along Monticello Avenue. And you can see, as I mentioned, Church Street having that kind of nice boulevard design, how to bring that into this neighborhood a little bit better, kind of build off of that, the success that you see there. And so one of the big parts of the recommendations was the future land use recommendations. And so kind of given all the feedback and the existing strengths and opportunities there and the existing businesses, these three districts started to emerge. So it became capturing the existing retail commercial activity on Granby Street into sort of a retail mixed-use district, so really building on that, and that's become organically kind of already a retail mixed-use district, so trying to build off of that even more and enhance that. Also, recognizing there's a lot of existing industrial here, but whether it's you know, businesses that have been there a long time or maybe new businesses, recognizing that on the south along the railroad tracks and figuring out ways to really accommodate them or incorporate them in any future uses into this new vision. And then also the residential, given especially the Villa Heights neighborhood to the east, it was important to develop a sort of a contextual future land use, you know, vision that kept them in mind, because what we didn't want to have happen was to, you know, build up, let's say, an area along Church Street and not have it really blend well into the neighborhood to the east, Villa Heights. So kind of different height, maximum height recommendations for that side that would be different than the interior of the study area. So really just trying to really contextualize where these different areas are in the study area and how that relates to the immediate vicinity. And I mentioned a lot of city properties in the area, so that became a foundation for a lot of the recommendations is, you know, how can we begin to visualize what could go on these sites given the community feedback. And so this is just one of the renderings that you'll see in the plan. So again, applying these different concepts, the open space, the land use districts, height frameworks, and community comments, and the vision began to take shape here. So this is just a you know, a vision of what could occur on some of those sites there. The request or the amendment itself was sent to all the civic leagues surrounding the site, and I haven't heard any official correspondence from them, but they were all very much a part of this process, you know, whether it was the virtual, in person, what have you, they were all part of this process thoroughly throughout the past 6 months or so. So staff does recommend approval of this, and I will also just mention Mel Price is here from WPA as well, and I'd be happy to take any questions you may have.
Commissioners, any questions for Chris?
I do have a question. Of the neighborhoods that you named, Would you say that it was like a robust participation from all of them? I went to one of the charrettes, and it was well done. So congratulations on that. But I wondered did we see a good distribution of participation from all of the affected neighborhoods?
I believe so. I think Mel can probably better answer that.
Okay.
And I'll give Mel credit for the putting on the charrettes and such.
Oh, okay.
So. Sure. Thank you so much. Mel Price with WPA. We did see participation from all of the neighborhoods, and we couldn't have done that without some Civic League presidents. So we met with them, and then they encouraged their stakeholders to come forward. We did go door to door, and we passed out over 600 flyers, and we also gave those to community members who passed them out for us. So we saw pretty good representation from all of the surrounding neighborhoods, and you saw that in the final celebration in person at Maker's Craft. Thank you.
Thanks, Mel. Within the proposed industrial district, there's an area just north of the tracks along Monticello that I understand hadn't been developed because it's a former landfill area, which would, I expect, prohibit from being developed as industrial use in the future. Has that been determined? This came up in one of the earlier meetings. And if it's doesn't have potential as an industrial district, or excuse me, if that doesn't have potential to be part of that, shouldn't we call it out, and list what it possibly could be? Mel's anxious to jump out of her seat.
All of the environmental work here has not been completed, so some of it has been completed. We don't have all the details on every parcel here. Just actually heard this afternoon from Economic Development, and they're applying for a grant to do the remainder of that work. And so that may need to shift if different conditions are discovered. But right now, I think this is an accurate reflection of what the community told us they would want to see as kind of an idealized vision. And then when individual projects come forward, we'll have something to check it against, but we'll need to do that further research that's required to really permit a building.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Commissioner Sunday.
I have another question. I don't want to catch Mel before she sits down.
Yes.
I see that one of your principles, I'm very excited about this, one of your principles is around equitable opportunities for development.
Yes.
Could you give me an example of what that might look like?
Sure. Actually, I'll tell you one story. There's so many people who came out for this, of all ages, from all over the city. There are some warehouses that have not been used in a while. There are former auto repair shops and things. There's a woman who called early on and said, I own some property and I just want to do something great with it. She owns some land here in Virginia Beach. She would like a community garden. She would like a farmer's market. She has been teaching, especially seniors, how to garden and grow their own food, and she would like to teach kids how to cook with that. There have been all kinds of ideas, and actually the residents in these areas, people actually came forward and said, I will pay for half of this if the city would like to partner on the other part of it. There were all kinds of surprises in what people kind of offered back to contribute to this, a plan for, I think, the greater good. So many different ideas. The Mosaic Steel Orchestra is here. I know they had mentioned that they want to continue in the community, and you can see a large green space there. That green space is meant to serve many purposes, markets, the orchestra, all of that. So there's just the whole gamut of possibilities for people to start businesses or run pop-ups.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions, commissioners? Chris, thank you. Mel, thank you.
Thank you.
Susan, ready to call the vote?
The motion is to recommend approval of the general plan amendment. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
I just want to, again, just thank you for the work that you've done, acknowledging the current displacement and the commitment for retaining the cultural significance of the communities. I love the equitable opportunities for development, and you snuck in a little missing middle housing, so I'm very excited. Well done. I say aye.
Ditto. I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Item two.
Okay. This is an amendment by the Planning Commission. So as you know, any establishment in the city of Norfolk, a restaurant that wants to operate with entertainment and with extended hours is required to get a conditional use permit. As part of that conditional use permit, they are actually tied to the managers. We in the city acknowledge that an establishment is only as good as its management. The problem with that is when someone simply changes a manager, they were required to go through the whole conditional use permit process again. The Civic League, Planning Commission public hearing, City Council, took about two months, a little bit more. We established an expedited process for that. So if you are simply changing your managers, you're not doing new hours, you're not doing new entertainment, just changing your managers, we created an expedited process. You submit an application, we have the management, the managers that you submit as part of that application reviewed by the business action team, the BAT team, and if all is well, it goes straight to City Council and generally even goes on the consent agenda. Great process. We started using it, working really well. And then we had some applicants that came to us and they said, well, we're a nightclub. Now, this process is not isn't available for nightclubs. And they said, well, I don't want to be a nightclub anymore. I just want to be a restaurant. I want to get rid of my DJ, get rid of the dance floor. I just want to be a restaurant. So we said, well, this is a great process to use for that. So we would now like to amend the zoning ordinance and allow that establishments that are converting from a nightclub to a restaurant to be able to go through this expedited process. Again, following on the heels of that, we said we have this new program for outdoor dining. Again, when you get a conditional use permit, we talk about the seating outdoors and indoors. We tie you to the number of seats. So again, we said, well, if we're trying to encourage outdoor dining, let's make it easy for these folks. If you are choosing one of these options that we have for the outdoor dining, let's make it easy for you to amend your CUP. Let's send you through the expedited process. You show us the floor plan, we make sure it meets building code, and you go straight to City Council. So for these two new items, they would also be eligible to go through the expedited process. Pretty easy. We think it's a great idea. It's worked really well thus far with the change of managers. Any questions that I can answer?
We're good. Okay. Thanks. You catch your breath. Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the zoning ordinance text amendment. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Item 3, Duncan.
The next item on the agenda is Duncan for a conditional use permit for a drive-through facility large scale at 2336 East Little Creek Road. The purpose of this request is to allow the restaurant to operate a commercial drive-through.
Thank you, Susan. As we already mentioned, it is located on the north side of East Little Creek Road in the Roosevelt Garden Shopping Center. Property is zoned commercial, RC regional commercial to be exact. This does line up with the future land use map, which earmarks this property to remain as commercial. Sorry. And as already mentioned, they are requesting for a drive-through facility, large scale, which does require a CUP in the RC, CR zoning district. Here we see a photo of the site as it is today. What they would like to do is raise the existing brick building that you see in the photos there and replace it with elevations, Dunkin' coffee and donut shop of their own. The two photos that you see, the two larger photos that you see in your slide, that's from the street view. It's a little dated. So I did want to show how there is a sidewalk on the site at this time. Here we see a site plan of the proposed new construction. The layout of the drive-through meets the requirements of the performance standards for drive-throughs, including stacking space, landscaping requirements, as well as pedestrian and traffic circulation requirements. And it also meets the design guidelines of the commercial pattern book, in that the drive-through faces away from the public right-of-way. And here we see the elevations, which would, if this CUP is approved, would be tied to the CUP. So staff recommendations, given that this segment of East Little Creek Road is a heavily auto-oriented commercial corridor where drive-throughs are common, and that this site meets the requirements of the performance standards in the commercial pattern booklet, staff recommends approval subject to the following conditions. One, that the site shall be developed in accordance with the Duncan conceptual site plan that we saw earlier in your slideshow. And that the site shall be developed in accordance with the attached elevations that you saw on the previous slide, and that all new utilities constructed on site or to serve the site shall be placed underground. And that concludes my report for this application. Are there any questions?
Commissioners, any questions for Joy? Well, stand by. I see the applicant's here. So we'll invite him up to speak. Robert Kellum. You would please just state your name and mailing address.
Yes, Robert Kellum, Kellum Gerwitz, 500 Central Drive, Virginia Beach, Virginia. I think Joy did an excellent job in telling you what we're hoping to do. If you have any questions on what we are planning, please feel free. But there's not too much to answer when it comes to a drive-through. We need the drive-through to sustain the business in this location.
Great, so. Thank you. Commissioners, any questions for Mr. Kellum?
Pardon me.
Mr. Kellum, the restaurant that you have, the Dunkin' Donuts on the corner of the shopping center, that's
yes.
temporarily closed, is that?
That lease is ready to be expired. It's a underperforming area, and I shouldn't say the area is underperforming facility, because it doesn't have a drive-thru. And more people use a drive-through now than ever, and with the on-the-go apps that we have now have, even promotes more utilization with less stacking, so it helps everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
No one has signed up to speak in support of this application or to oppose it. Any comments, commissioners? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thanks for coming down today.
The next item number 4, Family Dollar, number 33015. For the following conditional use permits at 5900 East Virginia Beach Boulevard, A, for the sale of alcoholic beverages off premises, and B, the sale of smoking or vaping products. The purpose of these requests is to allow the sale of smoking or vaping products and alcoholic beverages for off premises consumption.
Thank you. So the subject property is located in the Janiff Shopping Center, which is commercial. The future land use map does earmark this property as commercial, so it does not conflict with the future land use map. It is currently zoned CC, community commercial, which requires a conditional use permit for the sale of alcohol beverages for off-premise consumption and the sale of smoking or vaping products. But at this point, I would like to remind the commissioners that the applicant is not asking for, nor are they going to sell any vaping products should they get approved. Here we have two maps before you. One is a 1 mile radius of other facilities that sell alcohol for off-premise consumption. There are 16 sites within the 1 mile radius of the subject property. And then the other map, your tobacco stores / convenience store, is there are 3 tobacco stores and 7 convenience stores within a 1 mile radius of the subject property. Pardon me. And because we are required to also consider the proximity of other institutions such as libraries and schools, we have a 1 mile radius showing within our 1 mile radius of the subject property is the Janiff Branch Library and an elementary school. I believe it's Fairlong Elementary School. And this is the subject, the store as it is today. It is a Family Dollar / Dollar Tree. If this conditional use permit is approved, the square footage of the store, nor will the hours change. They will both remain the same. Proposed hours are 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. 7 days a week. Store is quite big. It's a little over 19,000 square feet. They did apply for a conditional use permit to be able to sell alcohol for off-premise consumption in 1992. They were granted it, but they never implemented, the CUP did expire. Pardon me. So here we have a one proposed site improvement layout. We have two options for site improvements. Here is a staff layout that staff has recommended, where six parking islands are added. As you can see from your insert there, there's quite a bit of pavement out there. So that would help bring the site closer to current standards. Or the optional option that has been given to the applicant / property owner is that they could present their own alternative landscaping plan that would be reviewed and approved by the city's Department of Parks and Recs and Zoning Administrator. Whichever option they choose to utilize, they have 6 months to decide. If they choose to implement the staff recommended site improvements, that would have to be installed no later than 6 months from the date of the CUP. If they choose to present their own larger, more comprehensive landscaping plan, they have until 6 months to submit that for review, and then they can propose their own time frames for each element or all of the their proposed conceptual landscaping plan. So staff is recommending approval subject to the following conditions. The sale of alcohol products and sale of tobacco products and alcohol beverages shall only be from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. No vaping products shall be sold. And then the landscaping, either staff recommendation or something that they propose. And that concludes my staff report. Are there any questions?
Thanks, Joy. Please stand by for questions. We have the applicant here signed up to speak, James Bally.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon. My name is James Bally, and I'm here today on behalf of Family Dollar Dollar Tree. I'm located at 500 Volvo Parkway, Chesapeake Bay, Virginia. And for those of you may be very familiar with us, but we want to make sure everyone here understands, we are headquartered right here in the Norfolk, Chesapeake Bay area, have been for some period of time. With me today here from Dollar Tree is Mr. Harry Spencer, the Director of Construction Analysis and Administration for Dollar Tree Family Dollar. Also with me today is Ms. Sharon Wesselhoft. She is the manager of our alcohol and tobacco licenses. So they're here today to show support and to show their appreciation for being able to be a business that participates in this community. I don't want to keep you too long, but I do want to hit on a few issues. As staff mentioned, this was previously approved for a conditional use permit. That was the time prior to Dollar Tree acquiring Family Dollar. And we acquired it in 2015 and began to do a revamp of the stores and begin to look at the overall strategy. And as part of that strategy, we began to explore alcohol and tobacco sales and to move more toward a grocery store that you would see in any of your neighborhoods. And being in this area and headquartered in this area, the location at 5900 East Virginia Beach Boulevard became, I don't know if I'm using the right term, someone at corporate might take issue with it, but a flagship station. We're proud of being from this area and wanted to make one of this location one of those. And so you'll see, as is noted, that it is duly book branded as a Family Dollar Dollar Tree. A question was raised in the pre-meeting about whether we're intending to do that all over the city of Norfolk, and not at this time. We're looking at it. We're still in the beginning process of it. We like this model because it really does address almost every need that a family and members of a family may need in their everyday shopping, from food to beer and wine and other products. So I wanted to hit on that. As staff also noted, we're properly zoned. We properly meet future land use map. And we had the opportunity, and I like the way that your staff has the process set here, with meeting with the community beforehand, before it's filed, so they know what's coming. And so we were able to discuss this with the Business Association. They've submitted an approval email, which is in your package in front of you. We also had the opportunity to meet. It was very detailed and fun meeting with the Lake Taylor Civic League. Went through a lot of the process. They were appreciative of the information. They liked the store. They've been shopping there. They commented on how nice it was. And so as a result of that meeting, you have a written letter of approval from the Lake Taylor Civic League, and we appreciate their help and their input. So very briefly, I do want to kind of run through a little bit of the background of what we do. We come to you for the privilege of selling alcohol, tobacco, and again, no vaping. We agree with that. We don't want to be a place that sells vaping. We don't want to be a liquor store. We want to be a grocery store. A family will go in and get their beer or wine to take home with their meals. We don't want to compete against liquor stores. We want, our hours are 8 to 10, as you heard. Our families are home long before you're even required to close a restaurant in Norfolk. So that's the customer base we are looking at. But we take it very seriously, and if you grant us the privilege to do it, I want to talk to you about the training we require all of our employees to do. We provide mandatory training on minimum age requirements and how those apply. What are the proper IDs to look at? This is above and beyond any state-required training. This is interior. Training on how to recognize and determine what is an authentic form of identification. Training on how to confirm the person presenting the identification is actually that person. It's amazing to me how many times you see people show an ID that's not them and they get served. So we identify that. We make sure they know how to do that. We make sure that they know how to that they have the right to refuse alcohol. Anyone who appears to be intoxicated, we typically don't have that problem, but we make sure that they're trained to do that. We train them understanding that their own personal liability, to make sure that it's their responsibility to make sure that we're in full compliance 100% of the time. And training on how to cooperate with law enforcement as a partner should they request that participation. We utilize all of that training, and also in every one of our locations we're equipped with surveillance video cameras. So cameras that are directly pointed at the area where the beer and wine is located in the store. It'll be in the middle toward the front. And also the entire site is covered with video cameras, but we do have one directed specifically at that to make sure we're in 100% compliance. And as a result of all of these steps and procedures that I've talked through, we're proud to say that we have a 0.04% violation rate across the nation. I do these across the nation. We take it seriously. We take the privilege seriously. We enjoy the opportunity to be here in Norfolk. We'd ask for your favorable consideration. I'm available for any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Bally. And I do want to acknowledge Sharon Wesselhoft. Thank you very much for coming down. And Harry Spencer, thanks for coming down. Commissioners, questions for the applicant?
Go ahead. Well, I wanted to clarify. You said that you had a 0.4% violation rate. Is that national?
Yes, ma'am.
Could you tell me about in the state? Because I have to do a little math, but it looks like you've got about 168 between Dollar Tree and Family Dollar stores that have active ABC licenses. Could you tell me the violation rate for the state?
I don't know it for this year, but I'm unaware of any, certainly in the city of Norfolk.
I meant the state.
Yeah, I don't know the state number,
that would
but
be
it's certainly it's not. It's certainly I'm not. We're not sitting here today telling you the rate in Virginia is 20%, but we calculate in all of Colorado. It's not that. That is indicative of how we do across the entire in every jurisdiction that we're in, and we're certainly going to make sure that we're you can be proud of this location with our corporate headquarters right down the road. So.
Okay, and 12 pending licenses. Are you able to tell me where those 12? I see that there's 12 Family Dollar locations that have a pending license
in the state.
I believe.
Yeah, I don't have that list in front of me. We can provide that in between now and the city council. But it, like I said, once we acquired Family Dollar, we began to go through this process, and it's a convoluted, process. You got to make sure the store is properly zoned for that. And then if it's not,
we're part of that convoluted process.
Right, that's right. this is a simple process compared to some of those. But I don't know that list right now, but we are participating in that process in Virginia.
So based on the information we have, there are about 20 Dollar Tree or Family Dollar locations in the city of Norfolk.
Right.
Can you tell us if the intent is to consolidate those into a fewer number of total stores? Is the intent to make this a part of your business model for all locations to have alcohol and tobacco sales?
We would envision a model that resembles a small grocery store with some additional. Dollar Tree sells different kinds of products. Family Dollar tends to be more what you would think of as a grocery store. And I think there's a letter in there I included, kind of our insert that you would see in a newspaper, so you can see what they sell. But again, this is our flagship location. We need to look at it and see how it moves forward. But that certainly could be something we would look at in the future. Those are decisions above my pay grade. But
right.
But certainly that's what we envision is moving toward a model more like this. We find the neighborhood likes it because they can do a lot of their shopping there. And very strong support from the Lake Taylor, the immediate neighbors on this.
I'm just piggybacking, you may not have the exact answer for this, piggybacking on what the other two members have said. So I'm very familiar with the store as a Dollar Tree. I've shopped it many times.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. Oh, you're welcome. The closest one to me is in Ghent, but this one's a larger store. So, but my question is, I'm familiar with sort of the packaged foods and some of the other items that the Dollar Tree has to offer. I'm not familiar with Family Dollar. Can you give us some examples other than the alcohol and the tobacco? And I'm sorry if it's in our packet and I didn't see it.
That's
of what kinds of foods that you would sell that make you more of a full service grocery store?
Okay, so if it is, we did have an advertising packet in here, but I'll just you can see on there we're selling the same kind of products you would see in a grocery store. Mountain Dew. I'm just calling them out from what I can see
here.
Your regular Gatorade, cereals, brand name chips. All this is brand name. This is not off brand.
But what about things like meats or fresh foods or frozen meats even, or like fresh fruits and vegetables or frozen fruits and vegetables? Like
we don't have any fresh meat.
Okay.
Basically everything else.
Okay.
So we're looking at that, and we're also looking at produce as well as part of this overall revamping of the model.
The question is, do you have like frozen bagged produce, like frozen broccoli or frozen peas?
Yeah, I believe we do.
I think the Dollar Tree might even have that. That was really what I was trying to get to, is if what kind of fresh fruit and vegetables you may have.
Yes, some of the issues with fresh meat are USDA.
Right.
Once you've begun to go over into that, other requirements.
Thank you. Commissioners, any other questions? No one else has signed up to speak for or against this application, so unless there's questions or comments, we'll call the vote. Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permits subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
No.
And Mr. Murphy?
No. We'll make that recommendation, City Council. Thank you. Moving on to new business.
Good afternoon. The first item under new business that we have is to initiate a zoning text amendment to revise and remove inconsistent definitions and fix clerical errors. This is part of our zoning ordinance cleanup that we do about twice a year as needed, and it's always been needed twice a year. So where we are just addressing things that that staff uncovers as they work through zoning applications with applicants and interpretations to just make sure it's clean and everything's consistent in the zoning ordinance. As we're aware, it's a very large document, and every now and then we'll read something and say, you know, we can make that clear, or we need to do this better. And one of the examples that was pointed out and from earlier in tonight's meeting is one of our uses is smoking and vaping combined together. And almost every time we consider it, we pull it apart and have to make a condition that it's smoking and vaping, but it's not vaping. So one of the cleanups would be to separate it into two uses. So the intention would be you would initiate it today. Staff would do some of the work, come back and present either in 2 weeks or at an upcoming Planning Commission meeting. We wouldn't anticipate it being on your agenda again until September.
Thank you, Paula. Questions for Paula? Good. We're going to vote on these separately, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. The motion is to initiate the zoning text amendment to the zoning ordinance to revise and remove inconsistent definitions and fix clerical errors. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
Thank you. And the second item of new business is to initiate a zoning text amendment to permit solar energy collection facility large scale in OSP zoning by conditional use permit, and I'd like to expand it, and changes or additions to related performance standards. We currently allow solar energy collection facilities large scale in our MI zoning, military installations, and we have received a request to consider it in our open space and preservation zoning districts. We are recommending at this point that it be by conditional use permit only, and we will come back in your meeting in a month and have this as an item for discussion and for your vote. And if we uncover any other best practices, we would like to be able to incorporate those too.
Great. Questions for Paula? Please call the vote.
The motion is to initiate a zoning text amendment to permit solar energy collection facility large scale and OSP zoning by conditional use permit and to review the performance standards. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. That's the end of our agenda. Commissioners, any comments?
I have a comment.
Yes, Ms. Shelton.
I would like to bring up to see if we can revisit the zoning for small box variety store and associated performance standards, whether that's through a new text amendment or whatever the methodology for that would be.
To do that, would we be initiating a new zoning text amendment?
To initiate a zoning text amendment, it would take an affirmative vote of a majority of the commission. So if you want to move for staff to revisit a text amendment in this vein of the small box variety store that was recommended for approval previously, you could do that, and I think that would trigger the process you're asking for.
And that's what I would like to move.
Thank you. Does anyone want to second that motion?
I second that.
Properly moved and seconded. Any discussion? For background, Planning Commission made a recommendation to City Council 2 years ago to create this use, and no action's been taken. So we'd like to revisit that as a commission, as the membership has turned over, and evaluate whether we still have that opinion or a different opinion, and then make another recommendation if appropriate. Any other comments or questions? Please call the vote.
Okay. The motion is to revisit the small box variety stores text amendment. Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. Commissioners, any other motions or comments? Mr. Homewood?
No, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Melita?
I'll just add to the last motion that to the extent the staff brings you information and you've made this motion, you're not required to vote yes or no to make a recommendation. You could decide not to forward the recommendation. So there's any number of places you could go once you start to process the information related to it. So
thank you.
Nothing else. Thank you.
Nothing else?
One more thing to say about
sure,
that. Sorry. As the gentleman from Family Dollar, Dollar Tree mentioned, he had an offhand comment about USDA requirements. Is there a way that staff could maybe look into that as far as fresh meat and fresh food goes? Are there really requirements that are particular that make it difficult for a small box variety store to exist? I don't know the answer to that. And I'm not sure who in the city would know, but that would be something I'd be interested in.
Great. Anything else? Then we are adjourned. Everyone have a nice afternoon.
Thank you.
Nice to get out of here with some sunlight.
Thank you.